By the time I'm done talking, if you're not out of the foyer, something bad happens. I'm not sure what it is, but that's what I've heard. Look at them. They're all coming in now. Just kidding. Well, if you're a guest, welcome today. We are so glad you're here, and we're glad if you're a regular attender, too, but the guest we really like, and we're glad you're here. I want to remind you, guest or regular attender alike, there are welcome cards in the seat back pocket in front of you, communication cards, and we'd love to hear from you. If you want to tell us a little bit about yourself or if you've got questions, use those cards to communicate with us. If you want to be part of a fusion group, somebody's having a baby, somebody's going in for surgery, all those kinds of things, we want to know and be aware of those things. So use that to communicate with us. Speaking of communication, in your bulletin, there's lots of details. You've seen the announcements. They've been scrolling. A reminder about the 40 days in the Word and the resources available there. But a couple things I want to point out to you in your bulletin. If you got a bulletin, take it out. And there's two inserts I want to make mention of. One is our Mother's Day brunch and fashion show. That's happening on Saturday, May 11th. So ladies, see all the details on there, all the fun stuff that's going to happen. There's a registration form there if you want to take part in that. And then also the one that says Teens for Hire. This is one of my favorite ones. Because guess what? At this point of the year, teens need money. They're going on mission trips. They're going to go to camp. They're going to have other summer youth activities. And they will do just about anything for a buck. So all those jobs that you're like, there ain't no way in the world I'm touching that job. We got all these wonderful teens that are willing to do whatever to make a few dollars. Yep, I see. They want to be the new version of dirty jobs. You know, you got that thing you don't want to do, hire a teen to do it instead. But there's an insert in there, in all seriousness. We want to bless our teens so that they can participate in these things during the summer. So you can seek one out individually. I think it indicate them on here, or you could talk with Pastor Jeremy, or just fill out the form generically, and he'll match somebody up with your job. So a couple things to be aware of. We have a membership class and open house tonight that I think Pastor is going to talk a little bit more about and hit on, but that information's in there as well. If you've not been to their house, Pastor and Dixie's house, before, even if you've been coming for a while, come join with us tonight. It'll be a good time. The staff and board and others will be there to fellowship with you. So, speaking of fellowship, take about a minute and 13 seconds to greet the people around you, and then we'll continue with service.
That is. And I want you to come up. You're going to get up, right? Don't stay in your seat. I don't care. Down there is fine.
All right.
Morning, Pastor.
Hi, Sharon.
How are you? Is Miss Dixie here?
She will be if she's not. Hi.
How are you?
Good. I think you've surpassed your minute and 13 seconds or 73 seconds, whatever that is. I love it that you're so friendly. This isn't the only time of the week that you can be friendly. All right. As we make our way to our seats, I want to mention a couple of things to you. This week, I want to bring to attention some things that are happening, and Pastor Ron wants to speak to one of those. Thanks for all of you that worked so hard at Too Good to Be Through. Another wonderful day. We had people there, people at Hope Center working at the fairground, distributing food. It was a great day. And thanks for all the work you do. It's always good when we get lots of feet in this building. And just to soak up the atmosphere, the friendliness, and to help others as well. So this week, our schedule's a little different. Aren't you shocked when we ever do something different around here? Oh, my lands. We got to keep flexible, don't we? Keep stretching. So Wednesday night, we're not going to have our normal service that we have for our prayer gathering because Thursday is the National Day of Prayer, and so we're going to be doing something here all day and to the evening, and we're going to have a gathering. So, Ron, why don't you just describe what's going to happen on Thursday and then their action step that they can help us with?
Well, we're trying something new this year. We really didn't have a lot of contact with anything that was happening in the city.
Not too much.
So we decided to do something locally. And this Thursday, the first Thursday of May, is the National Day of Prayer. We're going to open the doors at 5 a.m. for those of you who want to stop by on your way to work. They'll be open all day long, and they will close at 8 p.m. So let me just kind of give you the schedule of events for that day. There's going to be four prayer stations at the four corners of the worship center. One of them is to pray for the nation. And we'll have directives at these stations, but we'll have all kinds of directives to pray for the nation. But we're also, right next to it, going to have what we call Friends of Israel. We're going to have a station for people to pray for the nation of Israel. And I just think it's very timely. We're going to have a station to pray for the family, starting with the age groups from preschool all the way up, marriage, and those relationships. We're going to have a station to pray for the church at large, locally. And then revival will be part of that. So the church and revival. And the fourth station is going to be just personal prayer requests. It's going to be over here in this corner. And so the ushers, they have index cards, 4x6. Ushers, just come on up here with me. And they're just 4x6 index cards. And we need you to print. Everyone say print.
Print.
Don't write, print. And we want one request per card. Don't write a book because people will be coming all day long. Don't write anything that you don't want to be known because people are going to be praying for these all day long. Mm-hmm. And we will continue to pray for these requests through the month of May. All right? So there's going to be a station. If you have personal prayer requests, we want you just to lift up your hand, something you would like people to be praying with you about. Just lift up your hand and they'll give you one of these cards. These cards you can also get at the information center. The cards will be here throughout the day on Thursday if you want to fill one out, because we're going to continue to pray for them through the month of May. But just those things you would really like to have people agree with you in prayer about, just raise your hand and print a prayer request on these cards, and then put it in the offering plate or on the altar at the end of the service, or leave it at the welcome center, any one of those places. Also, communion will be available throughout the day. It'll be up front. We're used to just coming and serving ourselves, so that's exactly how it will be. You'll be able to serve yourself communion throughout the day. There will be a time of healing prayer from 12 noon till 2 in the afternoon. There will be a time for people to pray for you for healing. Now, it's only going to happen during the times I give. So 12 noon to 2 o'clock in the room directly behind the platform, the middle room, there's going to be healing prayer from 12 to 2, and then in the evening from 6 till 8. 12 to 2 and 6 till 8. Those two times there'll be people available to pray for you for healing. And then at the end of the day, between the hours of 6 and 8 p.m., Kathy and Nate and whoever will join them and friends, we're going to have a time of worship during that time, but it's going to be worship that just flows with prayer. There'll be prayer mingled with it. So just kind of a flow of prayer and worship and prayer and worship. And our team knows how to work that way. So it won't be a typical worship time like we're used to. You'll continue to be able to go through the stations. You'll be able to come to the altar. You'll be able to serve yourself communion. But we're going to be joining with people all over the nation to pray. I've actually seen more miracles on the National Day of Prayer than any other day of the year. Why? Because God's people are praying everywhere.
Yeah.
So we would just encourage you to come out as families, come out on your lunch break, come before you go to work, and the prayer directives are there, but you don't have to just pray the directives.
Right.
If you don't have time to pray through the directives, they're just there for your benefit. Just quickly go through and pray as the Spirit leads you. Fair enough?
Mm-hmm.
So make sure you raise your hand if you want some of those cards, and you can get those cards at the table on Thursday. Or they'll be at the Welcome Center as well throughout the week. Thank you.
Thank you, Ron. And just get your prayer requests to the Welcome Center, whatever, we'll get them. Anywhere you can put them, don't feel like you've missed it if you haven't had a chance to do that. The ushers are going to get primed up one more time because we've got little invitation cards. As we have really focused on this intense time in God's Word, one of the things we felt like we wanted to do was we wanted to have some teaching on prayer, on the Word. And so that's going to happen. I think it's the 7th, 8th, and 9th, if I'm not mistaken. If that's Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. So it's not this week, but the next week. So the ushers are going to come with the baskets, and there are little cards that tell you about it. Those are not tickets. Say, not tickets. No, no. It's just to remind you and something you can give to someone else. We've always wanted to do something like this because we're going to have a noon gathering. We're going to provide a simple lunch, and people can donate if they will to help. And it'll be about 45 minutes. You can come from work or wherever you are, from home, and come and go. But this is only going to be as good as you inviting and bringing people. This isn't just for our house. It's a good chance for you to expose people to some wonderful in-depth Bible teaching. But that's what it's going to be. And at noon, and then at 6:30, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, so that's a week after next. So these little cards coming around the baskets, come right ahead, ushers, thank you. It's just a reminder for you, and give that to someone as help them to know the details. So let's plan on that, and we'll hit that again next Sunday, okay? Go right ahead, ushers. Thank you. We'll receive tithes and offerings at a later time, but this is just for this. I just love it when good things happen. How many of you know that our church does a wonderful job reaching out to others? A number of us were at the Hope Center. Some of you go regularly, and that's under Richard Frazier's leadership. It's at the fairgrounds. They do two giveaways a month. The last one's food, and a lot of us got to go and participate at that yesterday. Such a good, good thing. So many churches and different organizations involved meeting the needs of people. So we just want to keep that before you and remind that we do that kind of thing going out to the block homes twice a month. And we always bring something because we're trying to teach our kids and our grandkids and ourselves to remember to pray. Every time you pick up a jar of peanut butter, this which is the item, bring a case, go to Aldi's, get a case, whatever, this particular ounce, this size, do it with a prayer and teach our kids. And everything we do just helps us to that end. Also, we support the Pregnancy Care Center, and we're doing the baby bottles. We'll pass those around another time. But we've done this, and this helps them. A great, great work for people that are dealing with pregnancies and things of that nature. So we are really, really excited about that and so thankful for the opportunity. One other thing I just wanted to mention before we get into the musical part of our worship today. But just to let you know, with all the stuff going on in our world, we have a great security team here. We're blessed with people representing different branches of whether it's military, whether it's State Highway Patrol or sheriff or city policemen and rapid response groups. And they've been meeting for a long time, but we're just starting to institute some things. And you know, sometimes that's hard for us because we don't like some changes that need to be made, you know, some simple doors being locked down and things like that. But I'll tell you, the Sunday after something happened, we'd be doing all these things, wouldn't we? So we're just trying to make some, so as you see things, don't resist it. You know, there's some doors we're locking just so people can't come in the front because that's very disruptive. We're working on some lockdown systems for some doors, even where an emergency button can be pressed on our electronic locks, and they can be shut down in a hurry. Our kids, Cindy's group has implemented a check-in system, and I know that's kind of painful, but we got to protect our children, don't we? So, and we're even going to have a sign, and we're getting input from these professional people about things that they see, and we're going to have some signs in the tunnel there. There's too much hanging out there. And it's distracting conversations, but it's also a safety issue. So just know these things have just been in process and work, so these things are just going to be happening over time, okay? So, and it's nothing new. It's not just about our church. It's just what we need to do to take care and be protected the best we can. All right? Very good. Is anybody glad to be at God's house today to worship? I love it. Rain and all. It's good to be here, and we have been so blessed with all the baptisms. Who knows how many? I lost count, but a lot. We've got a new members class today, and it's just to come to check it out. If you're here, you've never been, come today. If you've never been to our house, it's not because you haven't been invited. If it's been so long you can't remember, then it's time for you to come back, okay? Or if you were at the other house by the YMCA, but you haven't been to the one we've been at for the last 10 or 11 years, it's time for you to come back for a visit. Staff will be there. Board will come there. It's just a wonderful time for fellowship, and that's what we want to do. Okay? But we're here to lift up the name of the Lord. We have our communion corner set up again, so they'll take the coverings off of that. And really, you can come anytime. I mean, I'd prefer that you do it discreetly. I mean, if somebody's preaching or teaching, that maybe not the best time. But if you're coming and you're already kneeling, you don't feel like you have to rush back to your seat. But during worship, especially at prayer times, just come. And we're kind of experimenting about how many we need. And if we run out, we'll get some more, okay? But that's just for you to enhance your personal worship and all as a part of your tradition, whatever your heart leads you to do. So let's pray as we begin. Father, thanks for this great day. We look forward to these times of gathering. I'm just so thankful for all the people that have been in this building through the week and the love and the good things that have happened, the relationships. Thanks for the outreach that is so vast. Thanks for the prayer times, the times in the Word, for the study that we're doing together, for the testimonies galore that are coming my way as people dive deep into your Word. Transformational. Thank you for the testimonies that are still coming forth because they're applying the principles of FPU, Financial Peace University, and their lives are changed, debts dissolving. On and on it goes. You are so good. May your love be in this house today. We are so blessed to have guests every single time these doors are open. And we know we come from different backgrounds, no backgrounds, whatever, but I pray that the peace of God, which transcends our understanding, would guard our hearts in Christ Jesus, and we would just sense your presence in this place, and that all would be drawn to you, regardless of our age or background. Thank you for Kathy and her leadership today and her team, and bless her and anoint her as she leads us today. Thanks so much for the gifted team we have here, for the other pastors, the team that shared last week, and how we're all in this together. So we lift up your name, and as we gather through this week for National Day of Prayer, may your Spirit descend upon us. May you do something deeper in our lives as we come together. But we offer this time to you, and everything that happens, and a little later as we'll receive tithes and offerings, may we all participate. I just thank you for the faithfulness of your people in these days and what a difference that makes. And may your blessing rest upon the obedience of every heart and life here. So may we enter in now to worship and song, and may we fight through the rain or the whatever we may be feeling, and may we get in touch with you, the God of the universe, who created all that is, who breathed the breath of life into us, and who's given us your powerful word to change us. And may this be a day when changed lives happen. And for all you do, we will be grateful to honor you and bless your name. And everyone said, if you can stand for a while, that's great, but when you get tired of standing, feel free to be seated, but keep worshiping in your heart, okay? Come on, let's do that. Let's lift up a joyful song to the Lord. Let's join with Kathy and her team as they lead us. How lovely is your dwelling place, oh God.
Worthy is the Lamb.
The Lord reigns. Let the earth be glad. Let the distant shores rejoice. Clouds and thick darkness surround him. Righteousness and justice are the foundations of his throne. Fire goes before him, and consumes his foes on every side. His lightning lights up the world. The earth sees and trembles. The mountains melt like wax before the Lord of all the earth. The heavens proclaim his righteousness, and all peoples will see his glory. Do you want to see his glory? Let's just ask for it. Just lift your hands. Lord God, we want to see your glory in our generation and in this season of time. We want to see your spirit fall upon our nation and fall upon this neighborhood and this city, oh God. So Lord, let it rain. Let your glory come and let your people behold you in all of your splendor, Lord God.
Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there's no one like you. And then let the girls sing a while. Guys, we'll join in. Come on, let's continue to worship him. Lift him up. about Jesus.
My
story of God's
Jesus,
love. Girls, sing it all over the house. Come on, ladies, lift it up.
There is none like you. All of my days,
I want to praise.
I want to praise
the wonders
of your mighty.
Keep it going, girls. Keep singing, girls.
Love.
A little louder, though. My comfort, my shelter.
My comfort.
Sing it out. Never get over the fact of when we met you and the life change that took place. Not just future, not just in the past, but in the present and in the days to come. We love what you're doing in our lives. We honor your name. So may this be a posture of worship even now as we return joyfully, gladly, thankfully. In your name, Jesus, I pray. Amen. 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 Last week, we had them do a song that I felt like was just the perfect kind of theme for these 40 days in the Word. So I'm going to ask them again. And Bryson did just an incredible job, didn't he, on the recorder and the penny whistle, I think it was. So let these words just really sink in, okay? The power of God's Word. Transformational, that brings change. Quietly one more time. Did you get that? God's word brings change. Sing it one more time, Kathy.
Ancient
sing it out.
You know
it.
Ever true.
It's true.
Changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart.
And wherever we have God's word, we have testimonies. Give your attention to the screen, if you will. Thank you, team. By
race, but an agnostic by religion. My mother was not a churchgoer, so I didn't have a Christian background. When I was in my first year at university, some friends of mine, Nikki and Silla Lee, who now, well, have been my closest friends for many, many years, they came home one night and told me that they had become Christians. And I was horrified because they were such lovely people and I thought something terrible had happened to them. But I really knew very little about Christianity and I thought I ought to investigate. And I was going to read very widely around the subject. But the only thing I happened to have to hand was an old Bible that I'd had at school for RE lessons. And so that night, 11 o'clock at night, I started reading it. And I read all the way through Matthew's Gospel, Mark, Luke. Halfway through John's Gospel, about 3 o'clock in the morning, I fell asleep. Following morning, I started reading again. And I read all that day, all the next day, all the following day. I was a student, so I didn't have any work to do. And by the time I'd finished reading the New Testament, I'd come to the conclusion, it's true. And I didn't want to become a Christian. I thought that would be the most terrible thing. But at the same time, I realized what I wanted to do was put it off to my deathbed. But I realized that wasn't an honest thing to do. So very reluctantly, I said yes to Jesus Christ. And at that moment, my life totally changed. And I found what kind of unconsciously I'd been looking for all my life. And at the same time, I developed this love for this book which had spoken to me in such a powerful way that it changed my life. And since that day, virtually every day of my life, I have read the Bible. All right. And I've discovered these verses, which I've been asked to talk about a little bit today, are absolutely...
Thank you. The power of God's word. All week long, I've just been inundated by testimonies of people. Because when God's word goes out, it does not return void. I was thinking in this time, some of you heard that George Beverly Shea recently passed away. Anybody know that name? With Billy Graham Crusade for years and years and years. And I just happened, Dixie and I were on the road, and I was listening to his testimony that he gave a few years in the senior years of his life. And Chuck Colson, another saint of God, know that name, that's recently, in recent months, gone to meet the Lord. He talked about the power of the Word of God that totally transformed his life, and he never got over. So I share that because last week we ended with a declaration, the strong declaration, that God's Word is powerfully transformational. Has anybody found that to be true? Not just in the past, but in the present, in the days to come. It has the power because it's God's spoken Word, God's breath. The same breath that was breathed in, that was breathed into the nostril of man in those early days in Genesis, it's the same breath of God that is breathed into us now so that we can have life. We can't explain it, but it can't be explained away. God's words have supernatural power to create life and to change life. Psalm 33:6 says it. The Lord merely spoke. I love that, don't you? The Lord merely spoke, and the heavens were created. He breathed the word, and all the stars were born. We agree with that, right? And if his breath did all of that, what do you think it's going to do when he breathes his word into our hearts and lives? There's going to be change. We're never going to get over that experience. There's always a cause that creates the effect. God spoke and said, "Let there be light," and the Bible says there was light. It happened. Things were created and are created. New life comes at the command of his words. Jesus walked this earth and he continued to speak words of light and life. He brought the light of truth into a very dark world, and his word actually brought people back to life in every way and still does. As I was typing that this week, the words that we just sing at Christmas came to mind, that little bit from Hark the Herald Angels Sing. Life and light to all he brings, risen with healings in his wings. We still believe that, don't we? Only God in the flesh has the power. Only he can create and call things into existence from nothing. Uncomprehendable power. John 6:63. The Spirit alone gives eternal life. Human effort accomplishes nothing. And the very words I have spoken to you are spirit and life. Who's speaking here? Jesus and John. But some of you do not believe in me. The very words that I've spoken. Spirit-powered, light-bringing words. They have the power to do the impossible. We have testimonies here today. Hebrews 4:12 sums it up. For the word of God is alive and powerful. Is that past or present tense? Present tense, active. It is sharper than the sharpest two-edged sword, cutting between soul and spirit, between joint and marrow. It exposes our innermost thoughts and desires. What does? The word of God. Because the word is truth. Verse 13. And from this word, nothing in all creation is hidden from God. Everything is naked and exposed before his eyes, and he is the one to whom we are accountable. Another translation from another passage says that his word is living and active. That has to do with the word zoology and the idea of teeming with life. That creative energy or that power to change and to make things different. You can't touch God's word and not be changed if you touch it from the inside out. God's word, sharper and more accurate than a surgeon's scalpel. It's more like laser surgery, divine laser surgery. It points out what's wrong and what needs to be corrected. We all need change. The word of God can bring that about, that change that we're longing for. You know who you are and you know where you are. Change that you could never make on your own. I love this quote by D.L. Moody, a lay person that God laid his hand on and called into ministry. He said, the Bible was not given to increase our knowledge. The Bible was given to change our lives. Why was the Bible given? Ancient words, changing you, changing me. What a powerful source, what a powerful tool that is so often unused. If we totaled the number of Bibles that we own just in this room today, it would be staggering. I'm not interested in that number. I'm interested in how God's word is getting into us and transforming us. What do you have current? A current testimony say how God's word has challenged you and changed you. I'm having that happen in these days. How about you? God's word is powerful. It's living and active. And so I just want to go over in these final moments today together some real positive changes that the word of God brings about. And there are more. It's unlimited. Some strategic changes, if you will. Some specific things that the power of God's word does in our lives. First of all, I just want to tell you that wherever God's word is, it creates life or recreates life, okay? However you want to term it. God has the word, the power in his word to find you and to create life in you where there is no life, or recreate life where there was life and there is life no more. God's word has that power. The Bible says, and we've been seeing that in recent weeks, that we can be born again. That means we can have a whole new life. Any testimonies out there? I was going this way, but now I'm going this way. A 180. Never getting over that relationship. A new start, a fresh start. We can begin again. Before God, we can start over. He'll give us a clean slate. Has anybody experienced a clean slate? Your sins are no more. They're forgiven. They're forgotten by God. James 1:8 says it. He chose to give birth to us by giving us his true word. And we, out of all creation, became his prized possession, or his treasure, if you will. Salvation can only come through the true word of God. Without it, we could never be saved. We could never find true north and head for heaven. We wouldn't know the good news of Jesus. We wouldn't know about the empty cross and the empty tomb. We wouldn't know how to trust in God completely. We wouldn't be able to know God or to know his purpose for our life. And sometimes if we find ourselves wandering around in circles with no aim and no destiny, no purpose, that's a sign that we better be getting deeper into God's word so that he can guide us and direct us. 2 Timothy 3:15. You have been taught the Holy Scriptures from childhood. Some of us could agree with that, right? And they have given you the wisdom. How many of you know that wisdom's different than intelligence? Wisdom means backed up with life experience, put to the test. They have given you the wisdom to receive the salvation that comes by trusting in Christ Jesus. That's what our pastor friend was sharing today. He encountered God's word reluctantly, but he couldn't stop God's word from getting in him. You know, at the end of a message recently, maybe a couple of weeks ago, I shared a powerful testimony from somebody in our congregation about the deliverance from pornography. How do you believe that God can do that? And we focus on that, and that's great, but it's not just that. You fill in the blank with whatever it may be. The key was that he said, I started putting God's word in my heart and life. I read it again and again and again, and that made the soil fertile to receive the word of truth. How many of you know that's true? That's the key. Not doing it on our strength, not saying today that we can change ourselves, but submitting and opening our hearts as we just sang to the word of God and letting it identify and its power get in us and change us. The word of God, the seed in the soil of our hearts. 1 Peter 1:23. For you have been born again, say born again, new life, you know, but not to a life that will quickly end. No, your new life will last forever because it comes from the eternal living word of God. Where does it come from? The living word of God. As the scriptures say, people are like grass. Their beauty is like a flower in the field. The grass wither and the flowers fade. But the word of the Lord remains forever. And that word is the good news that was preached to you. We would not be here today in a right relationship with God saved if it wasn't for the good news of his word. If we had not heard, if we had not become doers of the word, God's word, living and eternal, the power within his word, living word to bring change, it's alive, working in the soil of our hearts. So James 1:21 gives us this admonition. In light of all that, get rid of all the filth and evil in your lives and humbly accept the word that God has planted in your hearts, for it has the power to save your souls. What does? The living word of God planted in you. Not just in your head, we need it there, don't we? But we need it to go all the way and impact our hearts. I'll say again from my perspective that I feel like this is the most neglected, often neglected area of spiritual growth. We underestimate the power of God's word when we put it in us because it's living and active. It doesn't just go in. It's not dormant. I mean, it begins to work in places that we could never imagine. When we need wisdom and direction, guidance, whatever, I just happen to believe that the word of God has every answer that we need. I've talked to people this week, one person in particular, that said that he and his wife pray and seek God's word before they make major purchases. Isn't that crazy? No, I think that's good. I think that's right, aligning our lives with the word of God. Man, how many testimonies do we have in this room that say, yep, God's word has transformed me. Powerful. And we're not ashamed of it. I heard another testimony this week from a guy that used to be in rock and roll and was made millions there, and he made a good point. He said when I was a teenager, I heard the good news of the gospel preached, I forget the text that he quoted, but he said, man, I made a decision then. I wanted to get rid of my sin. I thought, who wouldn't? So he said, I gave Jesus my sin. But he said, here's the problem. I never gave him my life. Right? You see what we're talking about? When God's word's in you, you can't just stop by giving your sin. Your sin, that's a start, isn't it? But because you're so love-driven, then his love compels you. You just want to keep loving him and obeying him and walk in obedience to his word, right? And I think Jesus said, this is how they'll know that you're my disciples, if you love God and if you love each other. And if you don't just hear my word, but if you do my word. That's what's going to make a difference to those who are watching our lives. And in this recreation of life, do you know the second thing it does? How many of you are glad that it eliminates guilt? I mean, if we're guilty, we're guilty. It's okay to be guilty if we did it. You know what I'm saying? We kind of written that word out of existence, but God has a cure for the guilt of our sin, our disobedience. We don't have to live hopelessly mired, in other words, in regret. We can be free of that destructive weight and the power of shame that goes with it. I meet many, and so do you, who can't seem to get over their past. Maybe they hold resentment and become bitter because of a way that they've been hurt, or maybe they feel guilt and shame because they've done the hurting. Some time ago, I preached about bullying, and so many people responded because they had hurt in their lives as adults because of bullying that happened to them as kids. But I also gave an invitation for people to come forward and pray who had been on the other end, and they had much remorse and guilt because they had been bullies. Got it? Whatever side, God's saying, I want to take your sin and your pain and your regret, and I want you to have forgiveness and be released from your guilt and your shame. I'm here to tell you and remind you again that it's not God's will that you go through life carrying all the baggage that you've been carrying, that baggage of guilt. He's provided a cure. He wants us to be free, guilt-free, and His Word makes it possible. 1 John 1, if we claim we have no sin, we are fooling ourselves and not living in truth. But if we confess our sins to Him, got that? He is faithful and just to forgive our sins and cleanse us from all wickedness. If we claim we've not sinned, we are calling God a liar and showing that His Word has no place in our hearts. If God has the power to forgive us, then He has the power to cleanse us. And it's in the cleansing, it's the forgiveness, but it's the cleansing, that there is freedom from guilt and from shame. Have you experienced that? I'm just asking. Have you experienced that? Romans 8:1 says, now, in light of that, there is no condemnation for those who belong to Jesus. You can't belong to Jesus without encountering Him in salvation through His Word. How many of you know that? In only responding to the good news of His Word can you experience the truth of this Word. What He cleans, He disinfects, He wipes away the stain. God has the power to wipe away our past completely. Amazing. Amazing. John 3:17 says that He didn't come to condemn us. What did He come to do? He came to save us. The promise is a guilt reliever. It's a shame reducer. It's a regret eliminator. The Bible's given us to show that our sin can be cleansed and we can be freed from guilt. Ephesians 5 echoes that in verse 25 and 6. Husbands, this means love your wives just as Christ loved the church and He gave up His life for her, to make her holy and clean, washed by the cleansing of God's Word. By the way, I think I shared this with a small gathering of men, but I was thinking about this verse the other day, and this whole idea of what it means to a husband to love his wife as Christ loved the church, and as He gave up His life, and to make her holy and clean, washed by cleansing. I jotted in the margin, and I just want to talk to men for a minute, like me and you. I wonder, I'm just asking, does our relationship with our wives reflect our love relationship with Jesus? God, I want you to hear me, guys. Look at me, if you're married. Does your love life with your wife reflect your love relationship with Jesus? I am of the opinion that it really is similar. Well, you just chew on that, okay? I had some time to think about it ahead of time, and I still don't have it totally figured out. When we willingly accept God's Word and embrace it into our minds and heart and life, it washes us. The guilt has to go. John 15:3 says that you are already clean because of the Word that I have spoken to you. When we're taught the truth from the book of God, when we receive it and allow His Word to make its home in our heart, we'll be washed clean, made new. Guilt can go. Some of you here today that you're dealing with that guilt and shame issue, can you give me the place in God's Word, if you stand forgiven and cleansed before Him, can you give me the proof text that says that you have a right to continue to wallow in that, that He's not powerful enough to take away your guilt and shame? Can you tell me and point me to a text where you say, God's dragging me through my past? No, He isn't doing that. He's leading you to everlasting life. Okay. You can't enjoy all the benefits of the Word until you come to a recreation of life, until you've allowed God's Spirit to deal with your past and its shame and the stain and the pain. And then when you do those things, that's when your faith begins to come alive. In other words, your faith is stimulated, so to speak, okay? It's activated, if you will, your faith life. It's a faith builder, in other words. And I believe as I read God's Word, and I've just been taking it in larger and larger quantities and trying to do what I'm instructing you to do, that the Word of God, it stimulates and activates faith in our lives. And we need this so much because so many of us lack confidence. Listen to me. And I've determined this. Many times we lack self-confidence because we've never settled the issue of God confidence. Many are not courageous. They're scared to death, afraid to take risks that might lead to fear of failure or whatever, or fear of dying, all of that because we've never placed our confidence truly in God and His Word. Romans 10:17, this well-known verse, it says that faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the Word of Christ. When's the last time you've had a conversation with someone about God's Word and its powerful changes it's making? When's the last time you looked somebody in the eye and said, I just got to share with you. I want to share with you how God's Word changed me and challenged me today. I got to tell you what God's doing. That's just not a testimony for new Christians. That ought to be a part of our gatherings. That ought to be a part of our fusion groups. That ought to be a part of getting together where we share excitedly something new that God's Word has spoken to us. Intentionally. It stimulates our faith. God's Word begins to come alive as we take it in, as we are in relationship with Him. It just comes alive. And we say, oh, for the first time we see it as living and active. I need to do this or I need to do that. Oh, I really can do all things through Christ who gives me the strength. And we put it into gear, faith in action. That's what it looks like. I'm not suggesting for a moment today that the Bible is a self-help book, because without the gospel responding to the good news of the gospel, the Word of God, you're going to be just spinning your wheels in the mud. But the application of an obedience to God's Word begins to grow our God confidence. And expectancy rises, it's increased as faith and confidence grow. Let me tell you a true story. I don't know how many of you know, but pastors in droves are retiring, and it's not just because of age. They tell us that 10 pastors out of 100 will make it to retirement. Once starting a ministry, will actually retire from full-time ministry. And I forget how many hundreds and hundreds in the United States alone are quitting every month. And it's quite common in these challenging days for pastors to experience emotional, physical, spiritual exhaustion. I hear about this happening quite often. And I heard about one pastor particularly who was actually planning a new church some years ago. And right at the beginning of this, I mean, he had a total meltdown at the end of his first full year of a church plant. Think about it. In fact, he literally fainted while he was preaching at age 25. He was totally spent. I mean, he just, whoa! He was emotionally, physically, spiritually spent. He said, I guess I wanted to do my midlife crisis early and get it over with. But he'd been working for a long time all that year, 18 hours a day, not taking time off, and he was loving every minute of it, no less, seeing great things. After that incident, when he collapsed in the pulpit, he rapidly slid into a period of deep depression, and for a year, he said, I just walked around in a fog. He said, I didn't know how I got into it, and I didn't know how to get out of it, but he determined that in the midst of this, that he wasn't going to give up. He was going to keep moving forward one step at a time, and he said, Lord, I'm going to pray multiple times. Don't just get me through this day, but get me through this hour. Get me through this morning. Get me through this day. As he looks back now, years later, he sees and reflects that during that extended time of darkness, God used that buried darkness to prepare him. I didn't say God caused it. I said, God, use this to prepare him for what's to come. Later opportunities that would bring even greater stress and more pressure. So God, during this time, honed his character and skills, even in a dark time, at an accelerated pace that would have never happened probably had not he encountered such darkness. And this humble pastor turned to God's word more than ever before. It was his lifeline. It was his oxygen, if you will. He said, I read it literally to survive. And even in that mode, guess what happened over time? He ended up flourishing. God's word stimulated and activated new levels of great faith, and he slowly gained strength and courage and confidence, not overnight or not in just a week. But he gained that God confidence as he began to take God at his word. It's one thing to talk about it and to teach it and speak it. It's another thing to walk it out. And he was learning. He said the book began to come alive. Even an Old Testament passage like Exodus 23, where God says, I'm not going to give you this land to the people all at once, but little by little I'll drive them out until I've increased your strength enough where you can see it through. This was God's promise to a new leader, Joshua. You know the story. And this became this pastor's promise as well. What once seemed impossible and overwhelming became possible. And he determined that he was going to invest the rest of his life in serving Jesus on his timetable and at his pace. He said, over time, I knew that he would give me the strength that I needed. And that pastor's name is Rick Warren. And that was in 1980. God's word stimulated and activated his faith and gave him courage and confidence to take on enormous goals. And the rest is the story of God. Can you take this home? Can you apply that to you? And when our faith is stimulated into action, you know what's going to happen? It's going to kindle spiritual growth in us. You can't help it. You can't keep taking God's word and taking those steps, having your faith activated, and not grow spiritually. It's going to happen, and it's going to keep happening. How do you know that you're going to keep growing spiritually until you draw your first breath in heaven? Doesn't make any difference. That's what I love about the study of God's word. You can get into it, and no matter how young you are as a Christian or how mature you are, there's more that you need to come to know. God's word. Acts 20:32, and now I entrust to you God and the message of his grace that is able to build you up and give you an inheritance with all those he has set apart for himself. He said, I'm going to build you up. That's spiritual growth. God's not done building you up and building me up. When we answer his call and become followers of Jesus, when we choose to believe, we belong. We belong in God's family, the word says, with all the privileges and responsibilities thereof. I think I see that many go through life oblivious of the opportunities, the power, the blessing, the benefits that are available as children of God. And the primary reason is because we are not deeply immersed in the Word of God. We have it, we know some of it, we remember some of it, but it's not our lifeline. It kindles growth because 2 Timothy 3 says so eloquently, in your version of choice, all scripture is God-breathed, we talked about that, and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. That's the purpose of God's word. Okay. If it's not in us, if it's not working in us, then how are we going to receive this? Because you got to have a humble spirit to receive correction. It teaches us, in other words, it shows us the path to walk on. It rebukes us. It shows us that we got off track, and it corrects us. God shows us the way to get back on the right path, and then it trains us. He instructs us how to stay on the right path. God's word, powerful. God's word illuminates our mind. Psalm 119, you've heard it said and taught, but how many of you know that that's the longest chapter in the entire Bible? In the longest book, it's the longest chapter. and it's all devoted to the Word of God and the power of God's Word. Do you think that's an accident? Of course it isn't. It says in 30:130, understanding your Word brings light to the minds of ordinary people. I honestly want to know everything you teach. Wow, what do you think God would do with that kind of an attitude and heart? I want to know. God, I don't want to just know it in my head, but I want you to illuminate my mind and my life and give me understanding, because I want you to turn on the light in me, and I need comprehension. You don't have to be a scholar to get God's Word, because it's living and active. It's powered by the Holy Spirit. He doesn't care who you are. If you're linked with Him in relationship, His Word will come alive in you. And even if you put it in doses and don't fully understand it, when you put it in, it works when you're sleeping. It works when you're eating. It works all the time. And it may be a message you hear, a teaching you receive, that'll cause that Word to just spark to life, explode with truth within you. But we got to do the work of putting it in. Somebody told me that they were in a great place where wonderful things are happening. If I named a place you know about in another country, a wonderful place, and they said, you know what I primarily live? All the wonderful experiences there that are good things that are happening, phenomenal things that I needed to feed myself. That's what they're teaching. We got to feed ourselves God's Word. Not to figure it out. If that's your course, you're on the wrong direction. Our job isn't to figure it out. It's to let God's Spirit make it known within us when we put it in and transform us, illuminating us. Remember that song Amy Grant sang, Psalm 119:105, "Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path." You know what that says? Just enough light for this step and the next step and the next step. And as you keep advancing, God's light of His Word just keeps shining out before you, step by step. I think a memory verse that we'll have in this time together is Psalm 119:18. Again, Psalm 119. Open my eyes to see the wonderful truths in your instructions. I got to tell you, I love God's Word. I love to read. But all the rest of the books can go, because no other book that I've read or ever read is living and active and transformational, where I can read the same thing over and over and get new light and understanding. How about you? God's Word. Well, we don't have to do it just as a religion. No, no, no. We have to feed ourselves. We have to get God's Word into it so it can work. I've seen this over and over, that when we get God's Word into it, it begins to elevate our attitude. Right? I've personally never seen a hopeless person that is full of God's Word. I haven't. I'm not saying one doesn't exist, but I've never, and I don't mean from the past, but where it's present, it's up to date. It's like an attitude elevator. Was it John Maxwell who used to say something like this? Attitudes determine the altitude. If we want to soar like eagles and all those wonderful promises, then we've got to let God's Word get into us and change us. Man. And I know some of you did it. Some of you mature Christians used to do this way more than you're doing it now. Did you outgrow the need for this? I mean, did you get too mature? Jesus said a lot of times we need to get like little kids again. To receive His Word. Romans 15:4, "For everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through endurance and encouragement, the Scriptures, we might have hope." One writer said that maybe we better start going to Dr. Luke instead of Dr. Phil. With all due respect to Dr. Phil. It's God's Word. You know, it's like unsinkable. You know, like God's Word is buoyant and you can't keep it down. You can try and it's been tried, but it just, boop, there it goes. It just keeps on floating. Oh God, open my eyes that I can see Your truth. Psalm 119:14, "I have rejoiced in Your laws as much as in riches. I will study Your commands and reflect on Your ways. I will delight in Your decrees, and I will not forget your word. That's how you move forward spiritually, folks. It's not very glamorous, is it? But that makes all the glamorous high points come to a new level in life because we're doing what God wants us to do. And finally, as we take God's word in, it'll unshackle our potential. I don't know. Visualize it like you're kind of this thing that's all deflated, and as you hook up to God's word and it begins to speak and breathe light into you, it just what was void and out of whack just begins to take shape again. There's a buoyancy. God's word. I wonder if we're living up to our potential. I don't think God's word gets us into boxes. The pastor shared today, I think it gets us out of boxes. You know, it gets us away from the you'll never be good enough, you can't make it. Why can't you be like your brother, your sister, you're not worth much, you'll never amount to anything. It's the word. John 8 says, I have John 8, 2:31. Wow, I never knew that. There weren't that many verses in that chapter. Then Jesus turned to the Jews who had claimed to believe in him. If you stick with this, living out what I tell you, you are my disciples for sure. Then you will experience for yourselves the truth, and the truth will free you. Look out. You may end up doing things you never thought possible. Amen. Is anybody glad for God's word? It's not glamorous necessarily reading it every day, and that's why we're doing this 40 days, because I believe that if we get in the habit of doing this and even forcing ourselves at times, that it's going to get so ingrained that we won't want to do without it. That testimony, we're going to bring up another one here in a moment just to conclude with. But that testimony, don't you love it? That God even worked with a resistant attitude, didn't he? Look at me. You can't stand up to the power of God's word. You can examine, you can turn over, you can start looking at it, and the very people that have set out studying to try to prove it wrong, they've been taken in by the power of God's word. That's my prayer for you. Another testimony I came across was by a now familiar character, but I want you to hear it. I'm not doing this as a joke. Life transformation. Give your attention to the screen. The power of God's word. Look for it. Look for the truth in this illustration. Are you with me up there? There we go.
I'm currently 66 years old. That's how long I've been on planet Earth.
I thought he was 88.
When I was 28, I was sort of into sex, drugs, and rock and roll, as they say. So at 28, some guy with a Bible came in a beer joint that I was running, and he wanted to talk it over. So I basically ran him out of the place. My sister is the one that brought him, and while he was in the back trying to get a Bible study going with the old guy here, yours truly, my sister's was up on the front, and she's handing out Bible tracts. So that created a little bit of a ruckus in the beer joint. So I had to go out there and tell everybody, look, the girl wants to hand out Bible tracts. Take them, throw them in the trash can, do whatever you want, but don't be messing with my sister here. I'll break your legs. So I ran the guy off, but later on I looked him back up when my life was pretty well going south in a hurry. So at 28, I finally sit down and listen for the first time in my life to the story about Jesus of Galilee, the one we're all counting time by. It is currently 2013 years since Jesus got here. 2013 A.D. Anno Domini. So we're all counting time by Jesus. I just decided to follow him 38 years ago when I heard that he, in fact, was God in flesh. Not only was he God in flesh, it took the blood of God to remove my sex, drugs, and rock and roll lifestyle, sin. That's the price. Well, I'm sitting there listening to that. I thought, man, that was a mighty kind thing to do for a scumbag like me. Not only that, it really would do no good to have my sins removed, which are many. It wouldn't do me any good, though, if something could not be done about the 6-foot hole I'm going into. And you too, by the way. So we're all sinners. Jesus dies on a cross to remove all of them so you can go, I'm guilty no longer. The price has been paid.
There it is.
God coming down in flesh did that. It's actually too wild a story to dream up by human beings, especially sinful ones. 3 days later, he guarantees me not only did he have the power to remove my sin, but he had the power to energize dead, cold flesh so it can stand back up on the earth again. Because of what Jesus has done, his death on a cross and his resurrection, he's guaranteed that you will live. So, as Jesus would put it, whoever lives and believes in me will never die. If you're not a believer and you don't believe God exists at all, about the only hope you have is he not be there. That's your hope. Maybe he's not there. What we're saying is we trust that he is.
Amen. The power of God's word. Well, let me challenge you with this. The power of the living God through his spoken word. Know it. Mark 12:24, Jesus said, your mistake is that you don't know the scriptures and you don't know the power of God. Do you see the connection? Know it. Know it. Know it. Accept it. Accept the authority of God's word. How many of you know that there's a problem with authority in our society? That's a spiritual problem. Accept the authority of God's word. 1 Thessalonians 2:6, and you became like us and like the Lord. You suffered much, but you still accepted the teaching with joy that comes from the Holy Spirit. And thirdly, and finally, act on it. Know it, accept it, and act on it. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. Oh, you know, my prayer for us is, as we move through these weeks together, is that we'll become not only hearers of the word, but doers of the word. I want you to stand as we dismiss. And what I've tried to point out today is that God's word brings powerful change, but it all starts with a relationship with Jesus. If you're here today and you've never taken that step of faith to come to him and place your trust completely in him, forgiving, asking for his forgiveness, forsaking your sins, you need to take that step. You need to take it today. His word will not come alive to you until you take that step and come in relationship with him. And as we conclude today, as we pray, if you're here and you want to make that step of faith, do that. It starts there. It starts with that basic step. If you're here and you've been so negligent about his word and depending on everything else, make a decision today. Father, thank you. Thank you for your word that's powerful and active and living. And I haven't even done justice to all the changes that it begins to make, but we've highlighted a few, and we're just so thankful for it. What freedom we have to access your book, the book of God, that it's living and active. We can't touch it without being changed and compelled. We can't be interactive with your word without your word getting in us. And that's my prayer for precious people. Because our congregation is filled with people that are basically biblically illiterate. Not everyone, but many. They have it and they can read, but they don't read it. Oh God, stir up our heart's desire to become hearers and then doers of your word. And may our attitudes be elevated. May we receive hope. And may all these changes begin to take place where people can see a reality of change in our hearts and lives. Encourage those that are new in their faith. Encourage those that are growing weary and well-doing, that have been following you and maybe drifting. Call them back to the heart of worship. which is really coming to your word for salvation, for life, for instruction, for all the things that we need. Release your power within us, I pray in Jesus' name. Kathy, would you just play and sing a little bit as we conclude? And when you need to go, and if you still are here and there's communion available and you haven't partaken, you can end the service in that way. But if you want to spend some time talking to God about your personal relationship with Him, do that. About some of the issues in your life, the neglect, if you want to pray about something specifically, end service that way today. As we sing, that'll be our benediction, okay? When you need to go, that's fine. I know kids are waiting.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
So many songs about opening the eyes of our heart.
Open the eyes.